Good afternoon, everyone. So Mr. Singh, the way he conducted the session, it's a big shoe to fill, but I'll try my best. But again, not afraid to be embarrassed, so feel free to point out if anything goes wrong, right? So the topic I'm here to talk about is building a future-proof digital strategy. By the way, a quick introduction, my name is Ankit Anand. I take care of central strategy at Bobble AI. We are a conversation media platform. And through the course of this conversation, we will see what a conversation media platform is, right? Yeah. So if we talk about Bobble AI, right? What we are doing here is we are building a conversation media platform. Now our mission is to make expressions, the smartphone conversations that happen, we try to make it expressive, localized, and intelligent with deep tech innovation. Now what I mean to say by that is that we have a smartphone keyboard at the core of our offering, right? A smartphone keyboard is integral to all your smartphone experiences, whether you're ordering food on Zomato or you are booking a cab, you're doing it on your smartphone. So that experience is what we aim at elevating through various solutions that we have, and through the course of this presentation, we will see what all those innovations are. Right? Now, today, through different panels and conversations, we have already seen that future readiness is important, right? Two things that have been talked about again and again since morning is the fact that cookies are going away, right? Third-party cookies are obviously going away. So marketers need to think of what alternate technologies they can use in order to achieve the same ROI that they used to have before, right? And the second fact is that customer privacy has come into picture. We are already aware of what Apple has done. Google is also on its way to do it. So it makes all the more important for marketers to debate on this, that what next, right? And if we think about future readiness, there are four key things that come to play. One is, of course, data strategy. I mean, just the last session was about programmatic, right? Where we spoke about how we can use the first party data in order to run a successful programmatic ad strategy, right? So data strategy, of course, sits at the center of it. Now, when we have the right data, when we have identified the customer, next thing is activating these through the right channels, right? Where exactly are these customers spending time? Where are they likely to engage with the most? What media formats are they likely to engage with? These are some questions we need to answer as we look through this journey. And of course, when we have the good data, we are using that data to activate customers. The next thing that's important is what kind of content are we engaging them with, right? And similarly, just acquiring a customer is not important. Once they have come to the fold, what all do we do in order to ensure that they remain engaged to the platform? Because I think everybody of us knows that it's always better to keep a repeat customer than acquire a new one. Obviously, simple maths, CAC, right? CAC is lower for a repeat customer. So that's why creating engagement tactics that keeps a customer engaged who has come to your platform is also very important. So let's start with data strategy first. Cookies, of course, going away, we already spoke about it, which caused the need for marketers to look at alternate strategies, right? And mobile IDs obviously come into picture, right? And the reason for that is that mobile IDs are, of course, going beyond your session, right? Whether you're using application A or B, your mobile ID is able to track it. Mobile ID belongs to a real user who is using a smartphone, who has downloaded an application from the Play Store, who is registered on the Play Store, right? It's cross-device. Based on the actions you take on your smartphone, a marketer is able to target you on, let's say, your tablet or maybe outdoors. So that's the power of mobile ID, something that a cookie was not able to give us earlier. So that's why mobile ID could be a perfect substitute. We strongly believe that. And that gives us a segue into why keyboard is also important. And yes, that links with our product also, which is a keyboard. Now, when we think about the keyboard, we talked that it's integral to someone's smartphone experience. Everything that they do in their smartphones, keyboard sits at the center of it. And if you look at the stats, you will realize that more than 100 times everybody is engaging with a keyboard. And the beauty of a keyboard is, and this is a very important point, that keyboard is an OS level application. Which all applications you are using, what's your session time there, what are inputs you have entered while you are using the keyboard in a specific application, all those data pointers are available. So you create a CDP, something that we did, and within the CDP, you have very rich customer insights available, which you can slice and dice according to your targeting and targeting objective, etc., etc., right? So that's the power of a keyboard. And yes, that's just a glimpse into how powerful a keyboard is. And if you see that on a daily basis, this is the volume of intents that we are able to generate over 80 million users. So if we just talk about shopping, 40 million times, more than that, every day, users are doing something that is related to shopping. They might be saying that, you know, sale chal raha hai, or they might be looking at big basket application, or they might be, you know, booking a cab at Uber. So all those are intents which are relevant to a shopping, right? And that's why these are intents that could also help a marketer, right? So if you see on the right, you know, you are chatting with somebody, you are searching something, you are going into the browser and, you know, doing a search query. Everything is happening through a keyboard. And that's how impactful it's going to be in your marketing strategy. And yes, every input collects multiple intents. And let me take an example to illustrate it. For example, if I am chatting to a friend where I say that, you know, I'm booking an Uber. So here two intents are essentially displayed. One intent is to commute, second intent is to book an application like Uber. Now, each of these intents essentially lead to a decision, and every decision leads to a transaction, something that every marketer intends to have. So let's say if you have data about your competition, if you have data about your own customers, then you can use that data to mix it with your first party database and then create a strategy that can help you in a even better manner. And yes, the best part here, it's a first party database, right? The insights that we collect from that data, it comes from the consented data that users have given to us, which means that, you know, it can just plug into your strategy and then make it very seamless. And this data can be used for, again, multiple applications, market intelligence, right? So if we think about market intelligence, if we understand what's the trend of our customers, what's the trend in our market, right? Then on the basis of that, you will be able to take a strategic level decision in terms of what products to launch, what markets to go next. Similarly, you also get an insight into what are users doing in your competition apps. For example, for an Amazon, what are users doing on Amazon app? What are they doing on a Big Basket app? What are they doing on, let's say, a Flipkart app? All such information pieces are available through the market intelligence offering, so to say. And all that can help you make a lot of top-level choices in terms of your marketing strategy. Then we have data enrichment, right? We spoke about first-party data, that there are some data points that are already available with every brand marketer out there, right? Now, how do you stitch it with more data that you can gather from more first-party data sources? That's what the data enrichment offering is about. Then we have identity resolutions. Again, how do you create the full persona of a user based on different kinds of non-PII information? So that's what identity resolution is about. So with the help of market intelligence, data enrichment, and identity resolution, you are able to make a lot of choices that could define the chart that your company is going through. And predictive audience is something we are already aware of, where we spoke about, once we have identified the data, once we have decided our strategy, then what next? What's important is to activate these customers, right? And then we do it through the programmatic ad platforms. And of course, I will not take much time there because already a lot of people have gone into the depth of it. But yes, if we talk about programmatic ads, then it helps us slice and dice data on various parameters like intent, your app usage, and the products a user is interested in. So you, as a marketer, you can go to a platform, you can tell them that, you know, my user, the target, the TJ looks like, you know, these guys are, let's say, booking Uber twice in a month. These guys are shopping, let's say, three times a week. These guys are searching all these terms. We create a segment of audience and then license it to you so that you can run programmatic ads through a DSP of your choice. It's that seamless, right? And of course, on the left, if you see, on through the keyboard, all those things are happening. Users are searching within the app, within the browser. Then you have all the data of app session time spent, which is of course useful to you as a marketer. And demographic parameters, location, these things are of course hygiene. And now we have geofencing, et cetera, to ensure that this data is even more pointed. Now, of course, we spoke about the power of data. Next, very important thing is also creating a content that users can immediately resonate with, right? And that's where, if we think about what major content formats do we have, then your rich media formats like emoticons, your stickers also become very important, right? We all know, I mean, this is something we already know, that how much we chat with each other, right? Every day we are opening keyboard more than 100 times a day, we are chatting with at least 15, 20 people. Just imagine how many intents you are expressing then, right? Mujhe shopping karni hai, chal Nike se ye khareed lete hain. A lot of things you are saying. Now just imagine that when a user says that, right then and there, you are suggested a branded content, right? Now, it might seem very trivial that it's just a mere sticker. What's the value add, right? The value add is that WhatsApp or any chat platform as an ecosystem was never open to marketers. And with the help of keyboard, you are actually able to enter into that medium also, right? So, and the beauty of a keyboard being the delivery platform is that it has a contextual AI technology. So for example, if you are saying that, you know, main raste mein hoon, I'm on my way. So at that exact moment, since you wrote on my way, the keyboard understands your intent to commute. It suggests you, let's say, an Uber service suggestion. It suggests you an Uber content. It suggests you, let's say, an AirAsia content, which you can share. Now, of course, service and product suggestion is there, which you can enable commerce from. On the other side, you also have your rich media formats like stickers, which help you convey the same information in an interesting manner. In the morning, one of the panel discussions about commerce media, Varda was talking about, you know, every new brand at least needs to create 5 to 6 impressions in order to create that impact on the mind. Now think about this media format, right? It subtly puts your content and brand out there in the subconscious of the user. So that next time they say, see something else related to your brand, automatically they connect. Ki haan yaar, isko toh pehle dekha tha, right? So that's the power of a rich media format like this. And the fact that it's suggested to the user on the basis of context and their intent makes it even more relevant. And memes, again, are also very important because that's the language of Gen Z and millennials, right? And something that anybody instantly relates with. Like, the best meme I like is the Daya one, right? I mean, when the door is secured, so that's how Daya is going to react, right? So, immediately you look at it and it's funny. And it's very powerful when it comes to controlling brand perception, right? I mean, you amplify a message that resonates with your brand in a meme and put it out there. Immediately people see it, they relate it with something they already know, right? So, I knew Daya and CID, so I immediately related with the Godrej meme, for example, right? And immediately there is an instant connect in my mind. I'll go and speak to 10 other people that, you know, maine ye dekha tha, this was so much fun, right? So that's the power we are talking about. That in terms of controlling brand perception while your entire data strategy is going on is also very important. Now, of course, we spoke about an acquired customer engaging them, right? So if we think about that, just think about modern chatbot experience. It's very plain vanilla, right? It's mostly text. You say that, you know, where is my order, then you get a very long order number and then it says that it will take 5 days. Just imagine if you can humanize it, right? And there is a sample that we have given that, let's say, if you are inquiring about where is my order, then, you know, there is a rich media format that is sent to you. So, of course, you relate better with it, your engagement with the platform is even better. So, that's the last bit of what, you know, we wanted to speak about. So, these are some brands we have worked with in the past, and just to sum it up, what we need for the next generation, because third-party cookies are going away, is a holistic strategy where you focus on the full funnel. So you start with building a powerful strategy around data, wherein you are building your first-party databases, targeting the right customers on the right platforms. You're also focusing on building the top of the funnel. And at the same time, the customers that you acquire, you're also engaging them. So that would be all. Thank you so much, everyone.